हेलो गाइस, आई एम डॉक्टर मुकुल मोहिंद्रा, योर ऑर्थोपेडिक इंस्ट्रक्टर हेयर एट एन अकेडमी. एंड आई एम हेयर यू नो विद दिस सेशन टू डिस्कस सम क्लिनिकल बेस्ड सिनारियोज, बिकॉज यू नो देयर हैज बीन अ बिग चेंज इन द पैटर्न ऑफ योर पेपर एंड मोर क्वेश्चन आर कमिंग बेस्ड अपॉन द क्लिनिकल सिनारियोज. सो आई एम डिस्कसिंग टॉपिक्स इन दिस सीरीज where clinical based scenarios are discussed, so that if you get questions based upon the clinical scenarios, you find it comfortable in your exams. So the topic I've chosen for this particular session, we have the angular deformities around the knee, very commonly over the counter used terms genuvarum, genuvalgum, because you know you may have photographs, you may have clinical based questions on these kind of deformities, asking the causes, asking the treatment, asking the identification. So that's why I've chosen this particular kind of a topic. So let me first brief you as to what do I mean by genuvarum and what do I mean by genuvalgum. This is valgum and this is genuvarum. Okay. Now if you see in this picture, if this is the knee, distal to the knee, you will find the leg has gone laterally. But if you see this picture, if this is the knee, you will find distal to the knee, the leg has basically gone medially. So when distal to the knee leg goes laterally, it is valgum. When distal to the knee leg goes medially, it is valgum. And a very easy way to remember, L for lateral, L in valgum. So valgum mein L aata hai, L means laterally. So you find the leg going laterally, it's genuvalgum. Another way to identify the deformities, you can calculate this intermalleolar distance. You find it to be more than 10 centimeters. Talk of genuvalgum. Or you can calculate the distance between the joint lines at the knee. This is the medial joint line. This is the medial joint line. You can calculate the distance between the medial joint lines. You find this distance to be more than 10 centimeters. That means you're dealing with the case of genuvalgum. So I hope you guys are clear with the identification of these deformities, genuvarum and genuvalgum. Now, a clinical assumption has to be, you know, proven on the radiograph also. So what you're supposed to do, you're supposed to go with the scanogram in order to ensure that yes, your diagnosis is correct regarding genuvarum and valgum. And scanogram basically means a full length x-ray of lower limb. That is what is meant by a scanogram. You have the x-ray machine, you know, that'll give you the full length x-ray of the lower limb. And what you're supposed to draw on a scanogram is something called the mechanical axis of the lower limb. So I'll just show you how to draw it. See, this point is the center of femoral head. And this point, this is basically the center of the ankle joint. So if you just see, I've connected the center of the head to the center of the ankle. So what I've drawn is basically the mechanical axis of the knee, of the lower limb. Now just see a case with genuvarum. See this mechanical axis passing medial to knee. But just notice a case of genuvalgum. And I hope you can see the mechanical axis passing lateral to knee. So I hope you guys are absolutely clear how to confirm your diagnosis on the x-ray in case of genuvarum and valgum. Just drop this mechanical axis from the center of the head to the center of the ankle. You find the axis is medial to knee, varum. You find the axis is lateral to knee, valgum. I hope you are crystal clear with this point also. And yes, again you can go with the same formula. Valgum mein L aata hai. L means mechanical axis lateral to the knee. So that's a very fairly easy way to, you know, never forget what is genuvarum, what is genuvalgum. Now once you've identified that it's a case of genuvarum or valgum, your next step is to quantify the deformity. So for quantification of the deformity, what you're supposed to measure is the femorotibial angle. Very easy. So this is a line in the center of the femoral shaft and this is a line in the center of the tibia. So what has been generated over here is the femorotibial angle. Okay. Now, even on a normal basis, if you draw the femoro-tibial angle, it's around 6 degrees. 6 degree normally bhi hota hai. So, normally also, you have 6 degrees of valgum in your knees. Okay. You find the femoro-tibial angle going below 5 degrees. It'll be a case of varum. You find the angle crossing 7 degrees. That'll be a case of valgum. Higher the angle, more the valgum. Lower the angle, more the varum. So you can also, you know, calculate the femoro-tibial angle very easy, and you know, it'll just help you to quantify the amount of the deformity. Now, once you have even quantified how much amount of varum or valgum you are dealing with, your next step on the clinical grounds becomes finding the bone that has the deformity. Teri kaun si bone? Which bone has the deformity? Is it femur that is deformed or is it tibia that is deformed? Very easy. See this case. सबसे पहले क्या करना है, ऑब्जर्व इन सुपाइन पोजिशन व्हाट इज द सिनेरियो. लाइक दिस इज द केस ऑफ जीनू वैल्गा एंड रीच अ डायग्नोसिस दैट दिस इज जीनू वैल्गा. द नेक्स्ट स्टेप यू आर सपोज टू डू, फ्लेक्स बोथ हिप्स एंड नीज एंड कीप लिम्स side by side, like I've done over here. I flex both the hips and knees of this patient and I've kept both the limbs, you know, side by side. After you have done that, look from foot end, from here, from the foot end. Now just understand, when I'm looking from this foot end, I'm just looking at the tibia. That's it. So if there will be a deformity in the femur, it will disappear. See, tibias are straight. So that means femur has the deformity. But yes, if tibia will have the deformity, that deformity will be evident here. So very simple, you're looking from the foot end, deformity gone, it's in femur. Because femur is not visible here. Deformity present, it's in tibia. So this is a very, very simple method with which you get to know, you know, which is the deformed bone. Is femur the deformed bone or is tibia the deformed? Clear with the simple method? Let me tell you on a gross basis. If there's a case of genu valgum, femur is generally the deformed bone. Most of the time, at least at the undergraduate level, And if genu varum is there, tibia has deformity. 99% of the cases, this is what you're going to find. The people who come to you with genu valgum, they would generally have a deformed femur. People who would come with genu varum would generally have deformed tibia. Yes. Another way to make 100% sure that you are dealing with deformity in femur or tibia, because you know your treatment will be focused to that bone that is deformed, you can go with these calculations. The lateral distal femoral angle, the medial proximal tibial angle, LDFA, MPTA. Very easy to draw them. So just see this pic. This is the center of femoral head. This is the center of ankle. So I've again connected the center of the head to the center of the ankle. So don't think I need to tell you what I've drawn over here. Mechanical axis of the lower limb. Now if you see this up, what I've drawn over here, this is joint line of the knee. And mind you, the medial side of femur projects a little more down. And if you see the joint line, it is never perpendicular to the ground. It is angled at an angle of around 3 degrees. Okay. So this angle that is formed over here is the lateral distal femoral angle. And this angle that is formed with this joint line with the mechanical axis, this is medial proximal tibial angle. Now, by and large, both of these angles, they tend to have a value of around 87 degrees. Because as I told you, this line is bent at around 3 degrees from a perpendicular. Now, if there will be genu valgum, femur will be deformed, this angle will decrease. And if this tibia will be going into varum, this angle will decrease. So, if you find LDFA less than 87 degrees, femur is deformed. In genu-valgum, you will find MPTA going below 87 degrees. So when you are able to measure these angles, you are 100% sure that this is the deformed bone. Because if in genu-valgum femur will be deformed, this angle will go beyond 87 degrees. If in genu-varum tibia will be deformed, this angle will go beyond 87, go less than 87 degrees. Clear? So I hope you guys are clear as how to find which bone has the deformity. Now, why is it important to find the bone having the deformity? Because I'll focus my treatment to that bone. Now, before I can tell you the treatment, guys, so let me just tell you first the causes. Okay, thank you for the lovely comments, Asta. Hello, everyone. Okay, so now the causes. Now, before I can tell you the pathological causes, I must brief you on the normal alignment, because you know anything that will deviate from the normal alignment will be pathological. Because our normal alignment is not straight. Now, from birth till the age of 18 months, you actually have genu varum. This genu varum is physiological, natural, not pathological. Okay. Now, from this age of 18 months to the age of around 3 years, you actually have exaggerated valgum. Sorry, not 3 years, 6 years, 6 years, yeah. So from this age of 18 months to the age of 6 years, you actually have exaggerated valgum, more than normal. Like normal is around 6 degrees, as I told you. So you can have up to 12 degrees of valgum. That may be natural. Now it is at the age of 6 to 7 years that you get the adult valgum value, which is around 6 degrees of the femorotibial angle. 6 degrees of that. That is natural in our joints. Now anything that will deviate from this would be pathological. So what are the causes of pathological genu varum or valgum? If you talk of genu varum, if a child has come to you with genu varum, then the commonest cause will be rickets for genu varum. And this will be closely followed by something called Blount's disease. Maybe I think you guys know what is Blount's disease. Proximal tibial physis tends to be defective. The proximal tibial growth plate is defective. So that leads to genu varum. So these are the commonest causes of genu varum in children. And in case your patient is an adult and he's come to you with genu varum, then what he's likely going to have is osteoarthritis in the knee. So these are the common causes of genu varum as per different age groups. But yes, if someone comes to you with genu valgum, more than natural, more than 6 degrees. Now, if your patient is a small child, then let me tell you, no causes mostly identified for genu valgum. Genu valgum in a child is by and large idiopathic. No one knows the cause. But yes, if an adult comes to you with genu valgum, then what he is going to likely have, rheumatoid arthritis in the knee. Please be very clear. So I hope you guys are absolutely clear. Osteoarthritis would end in genu varum and rheumatoid arthritis would end in genu valgum. So I'm not going to talk of these conditions, arthritis part, because they need a separate form of treatment. So my discussion will be focused on how to manage children with these deformities. So I hope you're clear with the causes. Genu varum, think of rickets followed by Blount's disease. Genu valgum, mostly idiopathic. Now, once you know this is pathological, deviating from the normal alignment in a particular age group, okay, you know the causes in the mind. So how to proceed to treatment? Okay. Now, genu valgum, as I told you, is by and large idiopathic. So, cause is not the game here. You don't know the cause. Okay. So, here the treatment will be deformity correction. Okay. So, you have to correct the deformity, that's it. You don't have to correct the cause because you don't know the cause. No TB, nothing at all. Genu valgum is idiopathic there. Okay. So, Pratik. Now please understand just one important thing. If you have to go for deformity correction, you must be clear with the age. And this age has to be more than 6 years. when you're touching this deformity. Never touch univalgum before the age of 6 years, because as I have already told you, that up to the age of 6 years, you can already have the exaggerated valgum, which is natural. So when we find even exaggerated valgum in this particular age group, you know, in particular age group below 6 years, we often take it as natural. So after the age of 6 years, if you find that exaggerated valgum, think of correcting the deformity. So that is the critical age for deformity correction in genuvalgum. And please ensure that if you're going with deformity correction in genuvalgum, all your treatment options should be targeted at femur, because femur is the deformed bone in genuvalgum. We've already spoken of it. Clear? Now, what to do for deformity correction? I mean to say, what surgery to be done for this deformity correction? This part is basically based upon indirectly based upon age of the patient, but I would say the years of growth pending. Kitni growth pending hai iske upar depend karta hai. Okay, now 1 to 2 years of growth pending, more than 2 years of growth pending, or growth plates fused. Three scenarios. Growth pending, you can calculate from puberty. Somewhere around 12 to 14 years, you get puberty. So that gives you the idea. Now, when you have growth pending, like 1 to 2 years, greater than 2 years, you tend to utilize growth for the correction of the deformity. So how do you utilize growth? You go with a medial hemi epiphyseodesis. Same here, a medial hemi epiphyseodesis. Just understand. See this case of genuvalgum. So what has basically happened, that this side has grown too much, but this side has not grown much. So if you see this medial side, it is growing a lot. So you damage the growth plate on the medial side. Epiphyseodesis, fuse the growth plate on the medial side. Fuse half of the growth plate on the medial side. So medial side growth stops, only lateral side grows, and with growth, the deformity corrects itself. But mind you, you have to do a reversible hemiepiphyseodesis if growth pending is more than 2 years, otherwise you might get the opposite deformity. So that is the only difference. This will be permanent epiphyseodesis, this will be reversible here. But yes, when growth is pending, utilize growth for correction of the deformity. But when the growth plates are fused, now you have to go with femoral osteotomy to correct the deformity. And I hope you guys are clear why I'm talking of femoral osteotomy, because femur tends to be the deformed bone in genuvalgum. And yes, when should you be doing the surgery? When you find mechanical axis falling out of knee. Mechanical axis knee se bahar chali jaye. Like just see this side. See the mechanical axis. It is not touching the knee. But see the other side. I hope you can see mechanical axis is still passing through the knee. So this side you can neglect, but this side you will go with surgery. So mechanical axis has to be outside the knee. Only then you should be opting for these surgical options. Because, you know, a bit of genuvalgum is very much acceptable because our natural tendency also tends to be valgum. So you can neglect this side. So I hope you guys are clear that in genuvalgum there is no cause. So solely your aim is deformity correction. But correct deformity only in those cases where the axis is falling outside the knee after the age of 6 years. Because up to 6 years you can naturally have extra valgum. And if you plan to correct the deformity, decide the type of surgery by depending, seeing the amount of growth pending. Good amount of growth pending, epiphyseodesis. Not pending, corrective osteotomy, femoral osteotomy, because femur is the deformed bone in genuvalgum. So are you guys clear? Samajh aa gaya hai sabko? How to treat genuvalgum? The interplay of complex factors. Because now I'll tell you how to treat genuvarum also. Now if you talk of genuvarum in a child, you know, there are causes. ब्लाउंस डिजीज, रिकेट्स, बिकॉज जीनू वैरम इज नॉट यू नो इडियोपैथिक. एंड माइंड यू अप टू 18 मंथ्स, 1.5 ईयर्स, यू कैन हैव फिजियोलॉजिकल वैरस. आई हैव ऑलरेडी टोल्ड यू नेचुरल वैरस. सो हेयर द क्रिटिकल एज ऑफ सर्जरी इज लाइक 2 to 3 ईयर्स. फॉर 2 to 3 ईयर्स वेट, बिकॉज इट माइट जस्ट बी द फिजियोलॉजिकल वैरस. सो वेट अ बिट. सो जीनू वेलगम यू विल डू सर्जरी आफ्टर 6 ईयर्स. जीनू वैरम यू विल डू सर्जरी आफ्टर 2 or 3 ईयर्स ऑफ एज. यू हैव टू वेट फॉर दैट नॉर्मल अलाइनमेंट एज, बिकॉज अलाइनमेंट ड्विंडल्स विद एज. फर्स्ट वैरम एंड देन वेलकम. नाउ वंस यू नो इट इज जीनू वैरम बियॉन्ड द एज ऑफ 2 or 3 ईयर्स, देन द गोल्डन पॉइंट, नो डिग्री एक्सेप्टेबल. दिस इज द रूल फॉर वैरम. लाइक फॉर जीनू वेलगम, इफ द मैकेनिकल एक्सेस इज फॉलिंग विद इन द नी, यू कैन लीव इट. बट फॉर जीनू वैरम नो डिग्री इज एक्सेप्टेबल, बिकॉज दिस इज नॉट द नेचुरल अलाइनमेंट. अवर नेचुरल अलाइनमेंट इज वेलगस. सो वैरम आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू एक्सेप्ट. सर यहाँ 1 to 2 ईयर्स ट्रीटमेंट क्यों लिखा है रागिनी? आई हैव रिटन दिस इज द अमाउंट ऑफ ग्रोथ पेंडिंग. 6 ईयर्स के बाद 12 ईयर्स तक ग्रो करना है. सो समवन कम्स टू एट 8 ईयर्स ऑफ एज, यू विल हैव मोर देन 2 ईयर्स ऑफ ग्रोथ पेंडिंग. That will be the scenario. But someone comes to you around 10-12 years of age, he'll just have 1 to 2 years of growth pending. So you decide the type of the surgery depending on the years of growth pending. Got the message, Ragini? Okay. So as I told you, that genu verum you have causes. So your treatment will be focused on causes first. But yeah, no degree will be acceptable after the age of 2 to 3 years. So you will intervene after the age of 2 to 3 years. Now, if your patient is a case of Blount's disease, so the problem here is this growth plate defect in the proximal tibia. So here, if it is less of verum, early cases, you can go with braces. And these are basically mermaid braces that you can use. Please have a good look at them, because sometimes the pictures can come in your exams. But yes, when you find they are late stages, high degree of verum is there. Okay, here you have to go with corrective tibial osteotomy. Okay, so I hope no one will question me why I've spoken of tibial osteotomy, because I've already told you when it is genu verum, tibia is the deformable. Now a little bit about when rickets is the cause, because this tends to be a very very special scenario, because here the cause is correctable. In Blount's disease the cause was not correctable. You cannot correct the physeal defect. So when you have rickets with a deformity, how to proceed? Now I hope you guys know that when you have to assess healing in rickets, what is the best method? May I know? Rickets mein healing dekhni hai to best method kaun sa hota hai? Yes guys? Do I need to tell you that if you want to assess healing in rickets, what is the best method? Should you be going with vitamin D levels, calcium phosphorus ratio, alkaline phosphatase levels, or x-ray? May I have some people answering this up? So 4 choices on your screen. So please, may I have some people? Okay, C. C means x-ray, very nice. Anyone else? Anyone else? Absolutely right, Rani. Bullseye. See here. Look at the growth plate. Look at this fraying. And you know, as I've given vitamin D, look how smooth the growth plate has become. So that growth plate flattens and becomes smooth. That fraying goes away as you treat. So absolutely right. So you see healing in rickets with the, you know, x-ray. So that is it. So rickets may mostly you will find genu verum, you know. So here, your first step is vitamin D supplementation. Give vitamin D. And as you are giving vitamin D, you are supposed to look for healing of growth plate on x-ray. So you keep on looking for healing of growth plate on x-ray. Because x-ray is the best way to assess healing in rickets. Now you keep on giving vitamin D and a stage comes when you find the growth plate healed. So rickets is over. Finish. Now at this point, check the deformity once the rickets has healed. Because half of the cases, rickets gone, व्हाट यू फाइंड डिफॉर्मिटी ऑल्सो गॉन, रिकेट्स के साथ डिफॉर्मिटी चले जाती है आधी केसेस में. अदर हाफ ऑफ द केसेस यू स्टिल फाइंड दैट रिकेट हैज गॉन, नो प्रॉब्लम, बट डिफॉर्मिटी इज प्रेजेंट. सो दीज आर द केसेस दैट शुड बी टेकन अप फॉर अ करेक्टिव ऑस्टियोटमी. बट प्लीज माइंड यू, देयर इज अ प्रीरिक्विजिट बिफोर यू डू द ऑस्टियोटमी, दैट इज नॉर्मल सीरम एल्कलाइन फॉस्फेटेस लेवल्स. जब तक एल्कलाइन फॉस्फेटेस लेवल्स नॉर्मल नहीं आते ना, हम कभी ऑस्टियोटमी नहीं करते. जस्ट अंडरस्टैंड, एल्कलाइन फॉस्फेटेस लेवल्स कोरिलेट विद बोन डिस्ट्रक्शन. एल्कलाइन फॉस्फेटेस इज अ मार्कर ऑफ बोन फॉर्मेशन. इन विटामिन डी डेफिशिएंसी पीटीएच लेवल्स आर हाई बिकॉज पीटीएच इज ट्राइंग टू रिजॉर्ब बोन टू इंक्रीज ब्लड कैल्शियम, एंड एल्कलाइन फॉस्फेटेस इज हाई टू बिल्ड बोन. So high alkaline phosphatase means bone destruction is also high. You cut a bone, when the destruction rate is high, failure. So you have to wait for alkaline phosphatase to be normal before you go to the osteotomy. So are you clear with the treatment of rickets with a deformity? Okay. Even if it is vitamin D resistant rickets, you have to give more doses of vitamin D. Okay dear. Till you are able to see the healing of the growth plate. So treatment there also is vitamin D. High doses. Now, if you're clear, I'll just check it up, कि समझ आया कि नहीं. So, just see this question. A child has come to you with rickets and genovirum. Vitamin D given for like 3 months. Growth plates healed on x-ray. But if you see, the deformity has not gone. So, you have been asked, when can you refer this patient for the corrective osteotomy? So, rickets over ho gaya. Deformity over nahi hui. Corrective osteotomy karni hai. What will be the prerequisite? May I have some people answering me this so that I know that you guys have understood? Yes. So when to do osteotomy? Ragini says choice B. Anyone else? Yes, Suprati. When AL, okay, alkaline phosphatase levels become normal. Perfect, Suprati. Give it to you. Anyone else? Yes, Uttam. Can I have some more people participating? See, no. Alkaline phosphatase levels become normal. See, I've cleared it up to you in a crystal clear manner that if you have to go with the osteotomy, alkaline phosphatase has to be normal. So give vitamin D, rickets gone, deformity present, go with osteotomy, but after alkaline phosphatase levels normal. This is a repeat question from the AIIMS exam. It has also been there in the JIPMER exam. So I hope you're clear with this clinical scenario based question. So you never go with osteotomy until unless you find alkaline phosphatase levels to be normal. So that is how you treat genovirum. So genovirum treatment will be guided by the cause. Genovalgum, there is no cause. So the amount of deformity will be guiding the treatment. Clear guys? So I hope you're clear with these things. And I don't think I need to tell you what is this photograph meaning to you. Genovalgum at one knee, genovirum at one knee. So one knee valgum, another knee varum. This is what you guys call as the windswept deformity. In children, this is generally due to rickets. But if your patient, he is an adult, then what is likely going to have is rheumatoid arthritis at the knee. So I hope you're clear with the cause of windswept deformity. And rickets tend to be the more common cause overall for windswept deformity. Yeah. So I hope you're able to identify the windswept deformity perfect enough. And guys, when you have genorecurvatum, this word basically means hyperextension at knee. That is what is meant by recurvatum. Here there are two causes you need to know. The first cause you need to know, ligament laxity. Is cases mein recurvatum milta hai, okay? And second very important cause, a case of congenital dislocation of knee. Here you find absent cruciate ligaments. So knee is unstable. So that is why the knee goes into hyperextension like this. So this patient you can see over here is a case of congenital dislocation of the knee. So these are the causes of genorecurvatum hyperextension at the knee. So I hope I am clear with all the causes of the angular deformities at the knee, varum, valgum, recurvatum. Samajh mein aa gaya hai. And do I need to tell you what is this criteria called as with which you assess ligament laxity? This was a question in the AIIMS exam that has just gone by. MBBS mein Raghav, this is for final year people, pre-final and final year. ओके गाइस, सो प्लीज लेट मी नो हाउ डू यू चेकअप लिगामेंट लैक्सिटी. ये टच कर रहा है विदाउट बेंडिंग द नीज, द थंब इज टचिंग हेयर, हाइपर एक्सटेंशन एट नी एंड ये, एंड द फिंगर गोइंग बियॉन्ड 90 डिग्री. वॉट इज दिस क्राइटेरिया कॉल्ड एस? मे आई नो? आई एम श्योर यू वुड हैव हर्ड ऑफ दिस क्राइटेरिया. यू गेट टू नो दैट लिगामेंट लैक्सिटी इज देयर विद दिस क्राइटेरिया. सो मे आई नो वॉट इज दिस क्राइटेरिया कॉल्ड एस? ऑलराइट, सो आई विल टेल यू नो इश्यूज. दिस क्वेश्चन वाज देयर इन द एम्स एग्जाम अ लिटिल टाइम बैक. दिस इज बाइटन स्कोर. So when someone can have more than 4-5 of these things, he has ligament laxity. So I hope you enjoyed the lecture, guys. So you're clear with the causes of all these angular deformities. You know how to manage them now, okay, depending upon what deformity you are dealing with. So hope you enjoyed the lecture. Please download the Unacademy app for more such material. A lot of free material is there. You can go with daily free test series also. That's available on the app free of cost. In case you like it, you can go with the plus subscription. This is the paid version where you can attend daily live classes, you can have structured courses also, you can attend tests and quizzes, and you have unlimited access to all subjects with the simple subscription and any n number of teachers, n number of lectures. Yes, I'm sure now you know that Preparator and Unacademy is also a joint venture, so you can also go with the iconic subscription. You can have both at a very good discounted price. You can check out the website for the rate list. It is very, very affordable. And if you use this code Dr. Mukul YT, you further add on 10% discount over these prices. Okay. And just introducing to you the last mile to crack NEET PG. This is a course starting on 8th of February. So would be inviting you to enroll for the course. So hope you enjoyed the lecture. Any questions after the lecture, after this class is over, this is the Telegram group I run. You can join up this group to ask me any doubt readily. So all the best, guys. Take care. Bye-bye. Good night.